In this session, we are going to understand and analyze and also examine various data types which are fundamental to the computer system, which is the fundamental topic in the entire computer system. What are data types and why the data types are needed to be utilized in the computer systems? Just understand this. The thing that we need to understand is, we always, when we use the computer system, we always will communicate with the computer system with a keyboard, right? The keyboard has the English alphabet letters. In addition to that, we also do have some numbers from 1 to 9. In addition to them, we do have some special characters. Can computer be able to understand the things what we are feeding? Here, this is the thing. In order to answer this question, we need to understand on what basis the computer system actually works. If you want to make a computer system running, it requires some specific data types. The common data types for a computer system, for any computer system, is a binary data type, right? That is not all. We are going to emphasize on this binary. As far as you people know that, the binary is just 0 and 1. But there are many things to be added to that. And one more thing is, why the computer system can understand only 0 and 1? Why not any other letters or symbols? The thing is, the storage element is a flip-flop. The storage element within the computer system or any other electronic device is basically a flip-flop. What is a flip-flop? A flip-flop is a binary cell which can either store 0 or 1 at an instance. So obviously, anything that we are feeding into the computer system should be translated to zeros and ones, which is in the binary form, right? So eventually, the data that is fed to the computer system should be stored somewhere, okay? The data that is transferred to the computer system will get stored primarily in two different locations. We do have two different locations within the computer system to store the data that is fed to the computer system. One is, as you can see here, the memory, and the other one is the processor's register. You know that every computer system will be equipped with a memory, main memory in fact. Okay. Why main memory is needed? The main memory is going to provide the computer system a huge storage provision for the program execution. Let me tell you, either in this class or any other class, either in this topic or any other topic related to the computer system, when you talk about a computer system, the fundamental thing that you need to understand is the computer system will only serve for execution of the programs. That is, the job, the total job of the computer system is to execute the programs. Where are the programs? The programs must be stored somewhere. Where those can be stored within the computer system? These programs can be stored within the memory. Okay, for that, we need to have a main memory which is connected to the CPU. I don't need to tell you what is a CPU. Obviously, when you want to execute a program, our central processing unit is going to execute the program by executing instruction by instruction, right? So we do have two locations. One is CPU and one more is main memory. The data can be stored both in CPU as well as the main memory. But primary data storage unit is main memory, not CPU. CPU is going to provide you the intermediate storage areas when the CPU is executing some instruction. For an example, when one instruction is getting executed, that instruction should be sent to CPU, right? So CPU need to have a few provisions which can accommodate the incoming instructions. So that is it. So we do have primarily two locations within the computer system. One is CPU registers and one more is memory. Now before going ahead, before proceeding further, let us understand what is a register. As I told you that the basic storage element is a flip-flop, you can imagine that A register is a collection of flip-flops. A register is a collection of flip-flops. Why two collective registers and in the combination of flip-flops? Let me tell you. As you already know that, there are several flip-flops. RS flip-flop, JK flip-flop, D flip-flop, and T flip-flop. No matter which of flip-flop it is, eventually a flip-flop is going to store one bit of information. It could be either 0 or 1. But the minimum storage measurement in the computer system is 8 bits. For that, we need to collect 8 flip-flops together. You cannot use a single bit independently. The single bit must be a part of a byte. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So, you can understand that the minimum storage measurement in the computer systems to store anything is 8 bits. Right? So, as you collect 8 flip-flops together and try to store some number, it will give you a byte. When you collect 8 flip-flops together, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, one more flip-flop is needed, it will provide you with a byte. This is the smallest measurement. That's it. Smallest measurement is not a bit, but it is a byte. Okay. So here, I need to talk something about a CPU architecture. CPU architecture. You might have heard about a CPU is of 16 bits or 32 bits. That is, when you buy a CPU, you will be provided with its fundamental data. That it is either 16 bits or 32 bits. For an example, all the Pentium series initial processors are of 32 bits. What does this 32-bit meaning? This means that this specific CPU of the Pentium series will always deal with the 32-bit data. Meaning, one single data element is equal to 4 bytes. Byte 1, byte 2, byte 3, and byte 4. Okay, with each byte of 8 bits information stored together. So, this is what a CPU is all about. CPU requires a size. What is the size of the CPU? Size of the CPU doesn't mean that the square area of the CPU. When you talk about a size of the CPU, you are talking about the data size that can be stored and managed within the CPU. That is 16 bits. If it is a 16-bit CPU, the CPU will always deal with the 16-bit data at a time. If it is a 32-bit CPU, the CPU will always deal with the 32-bit data at a time. But as you can clearly see, any flip-flop can either store 0 or 1. That's it. Okay. So, we need to understand various data formats that are going to be dealt by a computer system. Initially, the fundamental storage logic is a flip-flop. A flip-flop can store only 1 bit, but 1 bit is not of any use. That is the reason why the smallest measurement we kept it as at least 8 bits. But nowadays, we don't see 8-bit computer system. We see 32-bit or 64-bit. For that, we need to collect four bytes or 8 bytes. Let us go back to the data types. The data is just nothing but the numbers and the other binary coded information. And there is something called control information also. Control information is a bit or a group of bits used to specify the sequence of command signals. The computer system is going to distinguish in the data primarily in these two types. The computer system will deal with two different kinds of a data. One is the actual data that you're talking about, that could be either 0 or 1, a letter or a symbol. In addition to this, the computer system will also deal with some control signals. We will talk more about these control signals when we talk about the control unit. Okay, so till then, we will just keep it aside. Now, let us limit our discussion and confine it to just the data and the types that are used in a computer system. Okay, so the data types found in the registers of digital computers are numbers, letters, and the other discrete symbols. what could be the data types? Of course, obviously, you know that the numbers, letters, and the other discrete symbols. When you deal with a decimal number system, you do have 10 symbols. Letters in an English alphabet, in the keyboard, you can see right from A to Z. In addition to that, we do have special characters such as @ or hash. So we need all these numbers, letters, and the other discrete symbols to talk to the computer system. Eventually, here this is an important thing. No matter which format you're using, eventually there is a computer understandable format. Okay, there will be a specific code used by any computer system. So regardless of whichever data type that you're using, eventually it will get translated and converted to the data type or code which is implemented in that specific system. For an example, there are a few number systems. One is binary. Let me write it here. There are a few number systems. One is binary, one more is decimal, and one more is, let us say, octal or hexadecimal. Now let us say a computer system is designed based on octal number system, which means that any time when you try to talk to the computer system, you need to edit talk by using the octal number system, or there has to be a conversion happen every time when you talk to the computer system with some other language such as binary language or decimal language. That is, you can talk to the computer system in whichever language it is possible for you, but eventually that data type will get translated to that specific data type that can be understood by the computer system. That is very essential to understand here. Different computer systems are implemented with different number systems or language. Here I may use the language or the number system interchangeably, but in both cases I refer to the same thing, that is the data type. Either I could refer it to the language or the data type or the number systems. So the computer system will use one number system to which everything will get translated. Otherwise, the computer system cannot understand. So the binary number system is the most natural system to use in a digital computer. The number system will be based on a radix. Okay, we will see what is a base or a radix. Any number system that you're going to deal with will have a base or a radix. Let me talk about that. Let us understand what is base. As we already dealt with four different number systems, that is decimal, octal, binary, and hexa. Every number system will be based on some radix. This base or radix are one and the same. For an example, when it comes to the decimal, we do have a radix of 10. Okay, when you write a number 78 in decimal, we also do need to understand that this 78 has a radix of 10. Similarly, octal, let us say, octal will have 8 symbols, that is from 0 to 7. So when a number is represented in octal, it will have a radix of 8, that is 7, 4, 3, which is in the octal, will have an octal radix, which is 8. Similarly, binary, if it is 100, we do have a radix of 2. Similarly, hexadecimal, if it is A1F, if it is an hexadecimal number, we need to imagine and assume that this A1F has a radix of 16. Okay, which depicts that the corresponding number is in the radix of 16. So now let us understand the symbols. Every number system will have several symbols which are equivalent to the radix. When it comes to the decimal, the total number of systems will be equal to 10. When it comes to the decimal, what is the total number of symbols? The total number of symbols will be equal to 10, that is from 0 to 9. When it comes to the octal, the total number of symbols will be equal to 0 to 7, that is 8. Okay, the total number of symbols in a binary language will be equal to just 1 and 0. And hexadecimal, the total number of symbols will be equal to 16, that is from 0 to F. So the total number of symbols that can be supported by any radix number system will be equal to the value of the radix. I hope you got it. Okay. Now, let us understand the other number systems and the data formats which can be implemented and understood by the computer system. Most common number systems are decimal, binary, octal, hexadecimal. So when it comes to the decimal base 10 system, which is composed of 10 symbols as 0 to 9, and binary number system will have just two symbols, 0 and 1. Hexadecimal number system will have the, we have 16 symbols. Now, having discussed all these things, we should also know how one number system is going to be converted to another number system. Let us have an example. As you can see on the screen, that when a binary number has to be converted to a decimal number, how it is going to be done? So here, what we'll do is, we will try and examine, we will look and examine how various number systems will be converted in, will be converted to the other different number systems. For an example, a binary number system has to be converted to a decimal number system. So here, as you can see, 1011 has to be converted to 101. How we do it? Let me explain. I just want to convert 1011 to decimal. How I'm going to do it? Let us have a look at it. I want to convert 1011 from base 2 to some x of base 10. This requires something. Here, this binary number has a weight. What is the weight of a binary number? So let us have a look at 1011. Initial weight is, the first digit weight is 2 power 0. Second digit weight is 2 power 1. And the third digit weight is 2 power 2. And the fourth digit weight is 2 power 3. So when you try to convert this from one number system to another number system, what you have to do is, you just have to multiply this number with the corresponding weight. That is 2 power 0 into 2 power 1 into 2 power 2 into 2 power 3. This is how we are going to convert binary number system into decimal number system. In the binary number system, when you have a look at it, each and every digit will have its respective weight. The first weight is 0, second weight is 2, third number weight is equal to 4, fourth digit weight is equal to 8, fifth digit weight is equal to 16, next subsequent digit weight is equal to 32, so on. So in order to convert 1011 to decimal, these weights must be multiplied with the corresponding digit, and finally these are needed to be added for converting this one to decimal. So here, this 2 power 0 is equal to 1, 1 into 1 is equal to 1, okay, plus 2 power 1 is equal to 2, plus this is 0, 2 power 2 is equal to 4, but 4 into 0 is equal to just 0. And here finally 2 power 3 is equal to 8. 8 into 1 is equal to 8. So 8 plus 2, 10. 10 plus 1 is equal to 11. This is how a number of the binary system will get translated or converted to decimal number system. Okay. But what if we do have a precision, rather, you know, binary point, such as let us say 0.011. How to convert 0.011 into decimal? This 0.011 also has a weight. Right after the binary point, the weights will be as follows. The first digit weight will be 2 power minus 1. Second digit weight will be 2 power minus 2. The third digit weight will be 2 power minus 3. So when we go for it, 2 power minus 1 is equal to 0.5. Okay. 0.5 into 0 is equal to 0, plus 2 power minus 2 is equal to 0.5, right? 0.5 into 1 is equal to 0.5, right? Plus 2 power minus 3 is equal to 0.25. 0.25 into 1 is equal to 0.25. So if you want to convert a number right after the binary point, still as those digits have their respective weights, still you need to do the same thing. That is 2 power minus 1, 2 power minus 2 and 2 power minus 3. When you add them, you're going to get the answer. That is 0.25 plus this is 0.125. A bigger pardon. I'm going to rewrite this. So 0.11. This weight is 0.5 because this is 2 power minus 1. This weight is 0.25. Okay, because this is 2 power minus 2. This is as 2 power minus 3, it will be 0.125. So when we add this, what we'll get is 0.25 plus 0.125. 0.25 plus 0.125. We will get 5, 7, and 3. So the total, if it is 1011 point, if it is 1011.011, then it will have an equivalent decimal representation, that is 11.375. This is the exact representation. Okay, this is how we'll convert a binary number to decimal, as you can see. Now let us convert an octal number to the binary number system. Similarly, when you convert any number system to any other number system, each and every digit will have its respective weight. Let me show it here itself. Let us say there is 736, but now this is octal number system, right? In the octal number system, first digit weight is 8 power 0. Second digit weight is 8 power 1. Third digit weight is 8 power 2. We need to multiply the digits with the respective weights, and finally we need to add. So as you can see, 6 is being multiplied with 8 power 0, right? And 3 is being multiplied with 8 power 1. And 7 is being multiplied with 8 power 2, right? After multiplying all these things, we will get the answer. And of course, we also do have another number, which is right after octal point. This is an octal point. This is not a binary point here. This is an octal point. If a number is right after the octal point, then this number weight will be 8 power minus 1, right? So 4 into 8 power minus 1 is 4 by 8. So when you add all these things, you will get the answer 478.5. Once again, if you want to convert an octal number to decimal number, what you need to do is just you need to multiply each and every digit with its respective weight in the octal. After which, all the results must be clubbed. Finally, find out if you do have any digit right after the octal digit. Of course, we do have one. That must be multiplied with the respective weight. What is the respective weight right after the octal point? After octal point, the first digit weight will be equal to 8 power minus 1. The second digit weight will be 8 power minus 2. So in the similar fashion, we will be able to convert octal to decimal. So here, as you can understand, one fundamental thing, any number system, let us say, any number system, when it is getting converted into decimal, there are some fundamental thing to understand. Let us say binary to decimal or octal to decimal or hexadecimal to decimal. What is the thing that we need to understand? Let us say binary is X, 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 X. it should be converted to decimal. So binary will have 2 power 0, 2 power 1, 2 power 2, 2 power 3. These should be multiplied with corresponding binary digits, and finally we need to add. Okay, if we do have a binary point, right after the binary point, weights will be equal to, let us say it is binary point. Right after the binary point, weights will be 2 power minus 1, 2 power minus 2, 2 power minus 3. So we need to multiply the corresponding digits with the respective weights, and finally we should add them. So we will be able to convert the binary number to the decimal. So let us say, how is octal? Even for octal, we are doing the same thing, right? But octal weights are different from binary. Let us say there is a number XXXX, which is octal right now. So at that time, what will be the octal weights? 8 power 0, 8 power 1, 8 power 2, and 8 power 3. Should be multiplied with the corresponding octal digits, and finally they should be added. Similarly, if there are a few digits right after the octal point, again the same thing will be followed as a binary. So here octal weights right after the octal point will be 8 power minus 1, 8 power minus 2, and 8 power minus 3. Everything should be added to form the result. Hexadecimal also is no different from this. Now let us say there are four digits. These x, 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 x are hexadecimal digits. So the first one will be 16 power 0, second one will be 16 power 1, third one will be 16 power 2, fourth one will be 16 power 3. Must be multiplied with the corresponding digits, and finally to be added to form the result. Okay, when you do have a hexadecimal point, right after the hexadecimal point, the weights will be 16 power minus 1, 16 power minus 2, 16 power minus 3. Everything should be added to form the final result. This is how a number, any number system will be converted to the decimal number system. So this is the format. Yeah, as you can see, when we convert a number from decimal to binary, of course, it is very easy. What you just need to do is, you need to divide the numbers into two separate things. One is before the point and after the point. That is before the decimal point and after the decimal point. As you can clearly see on the screen, before the decimal point, there is 41, right? The 41 should be divided with the 2. When you divide with the 2, and you will get reminder. That reminder should be arranged in the inverse order to form the equivalent binary number. Once again, this integer 41, when it has to be converted into respective binary, you should divide this integer with 2. When you divide it with 2, you will get the reminders. Finally, you are going to get a final reminder once after the complete division is finished. After which, if you can arrange it in the inverse order, you will get the corresponding binary equivalent of a decimal number. Here, as you can see, 41 divided by 2 is equal to 20, and remainder 1. And again, 20 must be divided with 2, and remainder is equal to 0. Then, 10 should be divided by 2, remainder is equal to 0. As you iterate this process, finally, the division will get finished, because there won't be any furthermore subdivisions are possible. So, right from this, you need to arrange all the reminders 101001 in the inverse order. If you arrange, you will get the number which is already translated to the corresponding decimal number. This is how a number will be converted from binary to decimal. Okay, what about the later part, which is right after the decimal point? After the decimal point also, we do have a number. So what you do is, it is even more simple. After the decimal point, whatever it is there, the total number, what you do is, you just multiply it with 2. Okay? You multiply it with 2. You will get an answer. So after which, the number is 1.3750. You just observe this binary point, rather decimal point. Before the decimal point, whatever it is, you just obtain it, write it down here. This will be the MSP. And then take the later part. Right after the binary point or decimal point, you just got a value. That value should be multiplied with 2 again. That is 3750 must be multiplied with 2 again. Did you get it? So you will get 07500. And before the decimal point, you got 0. So this is the next number. Again, 7500 must be multiplied with 2. Now, when you multiply with 2, you got a number prior to just before the decimal number. So that will be the third one. Fourth one will be 1.5000 into 2 is equal to 1.4 zeros. So altogether will give you the number right after the binary point. Once again, whenever you want to convert a number from decimal to binary right after the fraction part must be directly multiplied with 2. You will get an answer. So before the decimal point, whatever it is, you just keep it separately because it is a part of the answer. Then total thing, before the decimal point, after the decimal point, whatever it is, the total value should be multiplied with 2 again. Did you get it? And then write the answer. Before the decimal point, whatever the digit, that should be written separately. Again, there is a value 7500. It must be multiplied with 2. You got an answer. In this answer, you have a value which is you have a digit just right before the decimal point. Write it separately. And what you need to do is the fraction part must be multiplied with 2 all the time. Every time when it is multiplied with 2, just identify if there is a digit before the decimal point. If there is a digit, keep it aside. Either it could be 0 or 1. Okay. All those must be written in the ascending order. Earlier, we have written the answer in the inverse order to convert a number from decimal to binary. But here, right after the fraction part, what we are doing, we're multiplying. When we are multiplying, we are just going to obtain the digits which are right before the decimal point. We are going to arrange them in the same order, which in tandem going to form the total corresponding translated binary value. So here 41.6875 will have an equivalent value of 101001.10112 Okay, this is how you convert a decimal number system to its corresponding binary number system. So similarly, hexa to decimal, I already shown you. There is no point in discussing that again. Anyhow, let me tell you once again that each and every hexadecimal digit will have a corresponding weight. That weight must be multiplied with that digit. That is, let us say 2AF. In 2AF, F has the least significant digit will have a weight which is equal to 16^0. That must be multiplied to F, multiplied with F. A also has a digit, that is, as it is the second digit, the weight is equal to 16^1. The weight of the third digit is equal to 16^2. So we will multiply everything and we'll, you know, add all the respective values to form the result. And decimal to hexadecimal conversion. Similarly, as we are converting decimal to binary, we are dividing with 2. We need to divide it with 16 as we are converting from decimal to hexa. That is 423 base 10 should be converted to base 16 number. So what we need to do is we need to divide it with 16. So answer is 16 and remainder is 7. 7 will be, you know, the least significant bit. After which 26 should be divided with 16. Okay. So here it will get divided for once and remainder is equal to 10. And A will be the next to subsequent least significant digit. And finally, 1 divided by 16 is equal to 0. And with remainder 1. Okay, so the answer will be 1A7. Once again, to convert decimal to corresponding hexadecimal conversion, we require the decimal number to be divided with 16 all the time. Each time we need to perform, when each time, every time we perform a division, we're going to get a reminder. That reminder will be arranged in the least significant bit order. Okay, again, when we arrange it in an inverse order, we will get the value. So when 423 is divided by 16, divided with 16, the answer will be 16, reminder 7. Keep the reminder 7 to form the result. Again, divide 26 with 16. Okay, reminder will be equal to 10. Okay, then and we got 1. 1 divided by 16. 1 divided by 16 will be equal to 0. Now, reminder is equal to 1. So when you form 1A7 in this order, in the inverse order, you will get the number 423 converted to the corresponding hexadecimal number system. So similarly, when it comes to hexa to binary, what we are doing? Simple. 9F2 has to be converted into corresponding binary format. So here, the thing is very simple. You just have to identify equivalent binary value of that specific digit. For an example, let me write it here. Hexadecimal to binary conversion will be proven to be very simple. That is, let us see, I want to convert 9AF to corresponding binary digit. What you have to do is, you just have to identify the corresponding equivalent binary value of every digit. For F, the corresponding equivalent binary value will be equal to 1111. For A, corresponding equivalent binary value is equal to 1010. For 9, I think the corresponding equivalent binary value is 1001. This is how a number can be converted into binary. That is, a hexadecimal number can be converted into binary. Okay, so this is how we are going to convert a hexadecimal number into binary. That's it. But ensure that the binary representation should be of at least 4 digits, the minimum of 4 digits. Rather, should be equivalent to 4 digits. That is strict rule. For an example, I'm just there is a hexadecimal digit. That is 1. This 1 is a hexadecimal digit. Corresponding equivalent binary digit will be equal to 0001. Every time when a hexadecimal digit is there, the corresponding binary digit will have 4 digits. Let us say 2. 2's equivalent binary code is equal to 10, but you should not write just 10. You should write 0010 to make it equivalent and corresponding binary value of the hexadecimal digit. This is how you're going to convert hexadecimal to binary. Data types. Before we get into the data types, I'll have to tell you that. So far we discussed about the number system. Now we do require the data types to be analyzed. What is the difference between a numeral number system and a data type? These data types are actually required by the computer systems for some kind of a signal processing. We'll talk about what is the signal processing and how our data formats are going to be helpful in your signal processing. Let us have a look at it.